Hello and welcome to another Protagonist Science video. Today, I want to talk about our brain, its extraordinary capacity to recognize patterns, and how we, for better or worse, taught computers to do the same. If you were ever interested in understanding our world, sooner or later, you will arrive at our brain. It is the host and manufacturer of our thoughts and feelings. It shapes our actions and decisions, produces our consciousness, creates what we call us, our personality and individuality. It is also the only structure in the known universe potentially capable of understanding itself. How can a physical thing achieve all of this? We do not have all the answers yet, but thanks to computer science and advances in software and algorithm development, we can draw some useful parallels. To understand the similarities between the brain and the computer, we first have to understand the information currency of our brain. No matter what we hear, smell, feel, or see, the only thing that reaches our brain via synapses is a binary depolarization signal, an electrochemical action potential of neurons firing or not, a one and a zero, so to speak. And like in computers, where bits can be translated to make sounds, images, or anything else, our brain can create pictures from the electrochemical bits our eyes send for us to see. Our sense-making and perception relies on the interpretation of these input signals through pattern recognition. From the moment of our birth, and likely earlier, our brain gets exposed to regularities and similarities in that binary code. Every time we move a certain muscle, or our retinas catch a particular wavelength, or our chemoreceptors capture a familiar molecule, a distinct patch of binary code reaches our brain. There, it gets associated with an action, sense, or event. Slowly but steadily, our brain learns to interpret the constant flow of binary code until we recognize faces or places, remember smells or colors or tastes. It is truly remarkable. How does it all work? While it is hard to grasp, both philosophically and scientifically, who or what part of us exactly experiences these expressions of binary code, there is no doubt that at the ground level, the neurons and glia cells in our brain perform the heavy lifting of computation on these input signals. The biology of single neurons can be understood as little decision units, where many inputs are collected via the dendrites until a critical depolarization threshold is reached, causing a new action potential to propagate forward through the axon, yet again to be perceived as input by other neurons. The sum total of our perception signals propagate upward the neuronal column, where gradually noise and weak signals get filtered out, where it combines with inputs from other layers responsible for attention, memory and emotion, until finally a clear picture reaches our minds. The intricate crosstalk of many neurons has achieved what a single unit could not. It extracted a useful pattern from electrochemical fluctuations of our experiences. While the exact details behind much of our brain's neuronal architecture still remains to be solved, this principle of many connected and layered decision units, or perceptrons in computer science, was the inspiration for today's deep learning and neural networks, and the groundbreaking advances in artificial intelligence that followed. Thanks to the pattern recognition capacity of neural networks, we now have computers understanding and generating human speech, reading human handwriting, beating us at our own games like Jeopardy or Go. Neural networks help scientists, businesses, or artists to solve problems or create new insights. While it was unthinkable to ever mistake a computer-generated human face with a real human a generation ago, today, neural network-based generative algorithms create images virtually indistinguishable from reality. Do you enjoy the melody playing in the background of this video? It was entirely composed by Aiva, an AI virtual artist, trained by recognizing the patterns in classical music like Mozart and Bach. Pattern recognition is hailed as the key to solve many problems in this world, maybe even all of them. After all, our brain's ability to recognize patterns has been the one foundational principle responsible for much of our science, our civilization, and increasingly, our machine intelligence. Which brings us to the question, can our propensity for pattern recognition be used against us and our creations? Algorithmic bias as an idea is relatively fresh. Many believe that algorithms could be either wrong or right for the task at hand, but not biased, since they perform the same operations irrespective of who uses them or what data is being processed. And for most classical algorithms, this is indeed the case. However, pattern recognition algorithms in neural networks are fundamentally different. The way we teach neural networks to recognize, interpret, or classify data involves machine learning techniques like gradient descent, backpropagation, or reinforcement learning, among many others. While the details differ, what these techniques have in common is usually the gradual optimization of network hyperparameters for a specialized loss function. Hyperparameters define things like the architecture or size of the network, or the learning speed, among many other tweaks one can do. A loss function is a mathematical term that captures how well a variable, let's say a pixel, can be reduced and mapped to a real number, to then be compared to other variables for similarity. The way to optimize the hyperparameters of a neural network is by trial and error, by giving millions of examples of the data type where the network ought to find patterns in. This heuristical learning approach works remarkably well, and sometimes even too well. Because neural networks are ignorant about the wider world, they can only find patterns the data have to offer. And these are often not the ones we humans deem relevant or desirable. And this is where the bias comes in. Let's say we wanted to teach a neural network to recognize cancer cells from pathology slides so we can speed up, automate, and improve the diagnosis of cancer patients. We start out by showing the networks hundreds of tissue slides with millions of cells from healthy and tumor patients, painstakingly diagnosed and labeled by human doctors in a supervised learning setup. We hope that the network will figure out patterns from the characteristic morphology of cancer cells to make a rapid call on whether the patient needs treatment or not. Surprisingly, after a very short amount of training, the neural network learned to distinguish healthy from tumor-containing tissues with an almost 100% accuracy. Even samples that were held back from the training data, and thus unseen by the algorithm, can be classified correctly with ease. The study passes peer review, the paper gets published. What an amazing achievement, one might think. But then, another hospital wants their tissue to be classified as well by the same neural network, and suddenly the algorithm cannot tell healthy from tumor cells at all. Why did it fail? It turns out that the dataset used to train and test the neural net was biased. Tumor tissue images were photographed with a different microscope in the oncology lab of the hospital, whilst the healthy tissues came from a microscope in the pathology lab. The pattern recognition algorithm took a shortcut. It learned that the fundamental difference between the tissues was not cancer, but a small shift in colorization of the pictures based on the different cameras in their respective microscope. The neural network never learned what the scientists wanted it to do, to look only at the patterns in cell morphology. These examples are common and widespread in machine learning, and deeply problematic given the role that pattern recognition algorithms have taken up in our society. Biased or unrepresentative data teach neural networks to be biased, so we have to be very careful what we show them. Imagine a world where all the historical injustices, existing stereotypes, and societal biases are just broken down to the easiest heuristic, the simplest pattern, to be forever enshrined and enforced by the algorithms. The existing data we have at our disposal, for example by mining the internet, do not teach algorithms to treat people fairly on a case-by-case basis, rather to judge them based on group statistics. Whether it's a woman's paycheck, a black man's criminal punishment, or a poor person's health prospects. Pattern recognition algorithms can only learn from what they see or experience, not what ought to be there. Which brings us to our very own brain. Computers find patterns after processing often millions of data points, whereas we humans have to make sense out of the limited examples life presents to us. This means that our neural networks had to evolve a tendency to overfit, pick up any and all types of patterns between experiences, even if ultimately implausible, incomplete, or plainly incorrect. After all, for most of our evolutionary history, an occasional overfitting error, like mistaking a shadow for a predator, was far better for our survival odds than the risk of missing out on the signs of an attack. In psychology, our propensity to overfit patterns would largely fall into the wider area of heuristics. Heuristics are approaches to problem solving, opinion forming, or decision making that are based on limited data yet do provide a quick, approximate solution, a shortcut, so to speak, to the task at hand. Our mental shortcuts are a direct result of our learned heuristics, and so are many of our cognitive biases. Affect heuristics, anchoring, availability bias. Many of our thinking errors, false beliefs, and cognitive biases originate from a misplaced trust in our ability to make out a useful pattern. Like artificial neural networks, our brain's understanding of reality derives from the information we expose it to, the things we hear, the news we see, the experiences we make. The input data defines what connections we can make, what understanding of the world we can reach, ultimately what we can believe about ourselves and others. Ensuring the quality and accuracy of data we use as input for our neural networks ought to be our biggest concern, our highest goal. Now ask yourself, what has been your input data, your information diet, in the era of social media? The pattern recognition algorithms driving social media content learned a long time ago that a shortcut to human attention is the remarkable, the outrageous, and the emotional. All viral content shares these characteristics. Accuracy, nuance, or compromise is boring and counterproductive to their business model, which is selling your attention to advertisers. Every single social media company wants you to spend as much time as possible on their platform, because then they can expose your neural network to input data from advertisers. The primary goal of ads has never been to just tout the pros and cons of specific products or create product awareness. No, ads are designed to bypass the rational layer of our decision making and to carve hidden associations into the pattern recognition machinery of our brain through exposure. They teach our neural network a false pattern between an unrelated emotional need and their specific product. And while advertising existed for a long time for that purpose, our technology supercharged the ubiquity and efficiency beyond our sense-making. Social media companies as they exist today do more than personalized marketing or even manipulation. They interfere with, alter, and purposefully bias our shared perception of reality. Which can leave us with only one conclusion. We are currently captured in a large-scale psychology experiment with no opt-out, no clear goal or exit criteria, and the longer we participate, the less we seem capable of even understanding our role in it. Is this really the future we want to live in? Neural network-based pattern recognition algorithms have taken the world by storm in many unexpected ways. Because of their similarity to our neurobiology, they can produce both eerily similar outcomes to human actions or interfere with human cognitive processes on a scale hitherto unimagined. It is as frightening as it is inspiring. Many might wish to put the genie back in the bottle, to return to simpler times, yet life moves mercilessly forward. We will have to adapt to these new circumstances. After all, we do have a lot to gain. We have the chance to build towards a world that is less harsh, biased, and small-minded as the one we currently inhabit. We can start today by disrupting social media's current business model with antitrust, democratic regulation, and novel incentives towards building beneficial algorithms for social interaction. we also have to take responsibility of our own data inputs by participating in information spheres that aid us in becoming members of actual reality rather than bifurcated virtual outrage narratives. We ought to strive towards nuance, accuracy, compassion in the information we produce or share, and be open to as many diverse ideas as our colorful world has to offer. There is never-ending beauty to be found in the patterns of our existence. We just have to give ourselves enough room to experience it.